We just want to tell you who we are and what we do in support of science and open science in Kenya. And we'll introduce ourselves. We'll talk to you about a little bit about Kenya's research productivity and then about the research infrastructures we have at the Kenya Education Network. We are a national research and education network of Kenya. And what that means is we bring together research and academic institutions in this country. We are known a lot, probably by most institutions, for internet connectivity. But beyond that, we are trying, or we are working hard towards letting our community know that we go beyond internet connectivity. Our vision and mission, essentially, to transform education and research through broadband internet connectivity. A few years ago, 1999 to be precise, this realization dawned upon five vice chancellors then that research rides on connectivity today. And that's what we do mainly, but not just connectivity, but promoting research itself. So we are hosted by University of Nairobi, USIU, and the Catholic University of Eastern Africa. So we have data centers and offices in these locations. So our ownership, it's important. Why we do this is because KENET sometimes in some quarters is not at all known. Who owns KENET? The universities and research institutions own the Kenya Education Network. Our board of trustees comprises of vice chancellors, CEOs from research institutions, the permanent secretary or what's called principal secretary, State Department of University Education, the DG in Communications Authority, one private sector CEO who we are here to identify, and our executive director. We are owned by the institutions. So our primary role is to create this environment for improved education and research productivity. That is why we exist. And that's what we want to do for you, researchers in our institutions. So how do we do this? The last few months, headed to 1 year, we are working hard to do researcher discovery. We've held a number of university research forums. We realized that the researchers did not know much about us, and we did not know much about them either. So we've been having forums in a number of universities. Kenyatta University, again, congratulations, very receptive. We already held, I think, almost a two-day workshop here, forum, and we talked to researchers and we listened to them and we learned what they need and they learned about us. And as a result, we are forging forward to help them to further their research activities. In the process, we managed to also host a workshop. Once we discovered needs, we want to address them. Some of these needs are in terms of hard skills. So we sit them down in workshops and talk to them about, among other things, the Africa Grid, Science Gateways, and others. So in essence, we are almost like the local agency for people like Sci-GaIA, the European Grid Infrastructure, the Center for High Performance Computing in South Africa, and many other things that are accessible to researchers across the world. We bring them closer home. And we have time for you in terms of training. We're also in the process of forming special interest groups for researchers that we find with common interest, and we facilitate them. Facilitate means you want to have a meeting, you want to hold a workshop. What is it you want to do to further your research agenda? A collaborative research, some seed money in terms of a research grant. We have all these things for our researchers in this country. We're doing a number of webinars on selected topics just to educate our community on research infrastructures to be particular, and we keep an active mailing list by which I think some of you got to know about this. So when we go around, we collect your contacts and we're able to reach out to you when we get to hear about activities such as this. One of the outcomes of our outreach was collaborative research proposal writing. We were privileged to partner with a number of institutions end of last year in the writing of our proposals. In particular, as the Kenya Education Network, we brought together a team of researchers from about five or so universities. And a number of you, even in this room, contributed to that proposal for high-performance computing facility in Kenya. This is one of the needs we realize that Kenyans have. Yes, we have, among other research infrastructures, digital certificates that enable you to access HPC resources outside the country. However, some of our researchers told us that, yes, this is nice, it's possible, but it would be much better if Kenya had its own resource. So based on that demand from our researchers, we, as the Kenya Education Network, did this proposal. We are yet to see whether we will succeed, or rather we, the community. So this is what we want to do. Act for and on behalf of the community in Kenya. A little bit about Kenya. Sometimes when we talk about open research, when we talk about productivity, it's nice to put some numbers to all this. We are doing a lot of activity, but we've discovered that not all this activity is visible where it matters. You discover that there are places as Kenyans that we put our publications that don't get to be seen on the map. This is what Kenya is doing. We are mainly strong in medicine, agriculture, and social sciences. That is interesting information for researchers that we may know if our efforts are beginning to show up on the map. As the Kenya Education Network, we have research analytics available at our disposal, and we encourage our researchers to talk to us when they need to do any form of analytics. For we have subscribed and we'll be glad to share some of this information for informed decision making. We compare our country with other countries, and we notice that Kenya is way below countries like that should be South Africa and Egypt, and even Nigeria. Kenya is that yellow line somewhere down there, among others. So this is where we are as Kenyans. Just compared with a few countries in Africa, of course we could do more. We are not exactly doing very well, I would say. Neither are we doing too badly, but that is really a matter of opinion. But we hope that when we share this kind of information with Kenyan researchers and decision makers, you should be able to take action and hopefully feel inspired to greater things in terms of research. We don't know where you're publishing. Maybe your journals or where you cite the institutions you're working in. Probably Dr. Kanyaru, by now, a few number of his publications do not reflect for Kenya. He who pays the piper calls the tune. And that's why we are glad that the National Research Fund came up with a lot of money, let's say, isn't it? That we may fund our own research and publish it as ourselves. Otherwise, if Horizon 2020 pays for your research, you must acknowledge them in a way, hopefully publish with an institution, maybe a university in Europe or in the United States. So we are glad changes are happening, but would like to let you know that this is what happens to us when we don't publish as Kenya. Kenya is active in terms of research collaborations, but again, this is just useful information that you may know this kind of information is available to you. Who do you collaborate with mainly? West and Southern Africa, very little in North Africa. We could do this for the whole world, and we could also be able to let you know where are potential collaborators for your research. In essence, what we are saying, as it were, is that we are an enabler. We are a facilitator, and we'd like to play that role very actively. We know who is doing what. Those are the top 10 research institutions in our country. University of Nairobi, KEMRI, ILRI, and so on. We have about 45 or so institutions in Kenya listed on Sci-GaIA. And that would be interesting information to know where does the institution fall for all its efforts and investments. And a lot of other analytics that we're able to share with our researchers in this country. To this end, what we are simply saying before, as Ronald comes up to talk to us about the actual infrastructure we have, is that the Kenya Education Network would like to play a very, very significant role in your efforts to improve your research activities in your institution. We are very, very eager to visit your institution and hear what you need and possibly facilitate the development of whatever infrastructure you lack or whatever infrastructure you lack access to. So with those remarks, I would like to welcome Ronald to tell us a little more about the actual research infrastructure that we have at the Kenya Education Network.
And together with Moses, we help spearhead research infrastructures at KENET. So mine is to walk you through this last segment of our presentation, and hopefully you'll be able to see the role KENET plays in this whole ecosystem. So when we talk about research infrastructures, I believe you've already heard about the term e-infrastructures from the earlier presentations. When we talk about research infrastructures, what are we referring to? It means the facilities, resources, and related services used by the scientific community to conduct top-level research. So, you remember earlier today, I would like to pick a quote from Roberto during his presentation. He said that research has continually become computationally intensive, And what this means is that as KENET, as Kenyatta University, as the whole university ecosystem, and also as the country, we have to change or adapt our ways to fit into this, because that's where research is going. Research is more and more data intensive. That means we are analyzing large chunks of data, or even if you are not analyzing huge chunks of data, what we are doing is that we are creating simulations to, like, for example, like an engineer is building a bridge. There's no way of testing a bridge. Yeah? You can only simulate and then build the bridge afterwards. Once you build it, you can't test by destroying it, like a software program, for example. So it has to stay there. So the only way to prove that it's going to serve its purpose is by running a simulation. And then you can go ahead and build the bridge according to the specifications which you've learned from what your research has informed you. So our role at KENET is to be the vehicle that researchers in the whole ecosystem use to access research infrastructures. And looking at this diagram here, there are three things. On the left-hand side there, we have high-performance computing and storage. And this basically is e-infrastructures, what you've had today in the morning. And then on the right and on the left, we have astronomy, medicine, and genomics. Of course, there are many fields, but the diagram just shows you that as a researcher, now you are going to have access to all this. And in line with the theme of this workshop, we are talking about openness. I think it was said earlier, I think from the presentation by Simon, about publishing the data and then sharing and also promoting reuse. And that is the key. You might be a researcher here in Kenyatta University, wish to conduct research in a particular area, and you might be having even challenges having access to the data to use to work on your research. But probably a researcher somewhere has already shared this data online. And so you can log into a repository, probably that has been plugged into one of the gateways, and you can access this thing. So at KENET, what do we have in store for you? What we have at KENET is a division which we nowadays refer to as KENET Research Services. And so what we have there is digital certificates. We have federated identity. And I think some of these terms are already familiar, given the presentations we've had from morning. And then we do have EduRoam, which is a wireless roaming service. And lastly, video conferencing. I'll be mentioning each one of them. So our role at KENET, first of all, what we provide as KENET is connectivity. We connect institutions to broadband internet. That's what we do at KENET. But then is that what we are supposed to do? We are supposed to transform research in this country. So we provide you with the internet, and not just internet, broadband internet. And I want you to get that clearly, because that's the difference between KENET and the other internet providers. There is a difference between the two internets, if I may so call it. So we give you high-speed internet access and also expose researchers and users of the KENET network to research infrastructures. That's what we do. And it's also through such workshops that we are able to do this. So there are a number of things. A digital certificate, I want you to read this definition up to the point we have passport in quotes, and then stop there. Don't continue reading further. Think of it as a passport. Yeah, a passport does basically identifies you and contains extra information for use by other authorities. So that's what a digital certificate does. So I want us to stop at that point. Don't bother reading up the rest. And then what a digital certificate does is that it enables you as a researcher to access resources which are not necessarily sitting in your country. It could be in Europe, in the US. But with your digital certificate, you are able to access these resources. And the reason why I was telling you to stop at reading the definition of the word passport is because I want you to compare it to the actual passport which were issued by the Ministry of Immigration. You are issued by a passport here in Kenya, by the Ministry of Immigration. You travel to Italy, you travel to Uganda, travel to Tanzania, wherever. But the authorities on that other side, they were not there when you were being issued with a passport, but they are able to recognize it and accept you into their country. So it wouldn't be possible without the passport, isn't it, to visit another country, because there's no way of identifying you. But with the passport, it's possible. So same thing again with in computing now. We have some good friends out there, our partners, who have computing resources, and they have shared these in what we refer to as a grid. And to provide access to researchers, even from this side, to those infrastructure, they need a way of identifying you. So how do they identify you? Digital certificate. So I'll skip on to the next, but maybe it's good to mention that what grid computing does is that it harnesses the power of unused processing cycles. Right now, there are a number of us who have computers, but let's say you leave your computer on idle. It is on, but the processing cycles are not being used much by anything. It's just the operating system keeping itself alive. These processing cycles can be shared by other people across the world. And that's how the grid computing harnesses all this to create very huge platforms, like with petabytes of storage and so many CPUs. Again, next on to something which I believe by now is very familiar to you guys, identity provider. And the good thing is that we also already saw a demo of it a short while ago when Martin was doing a demo of that application here. This one, again, works in kind of a similar way to the digital certificate, but it's more of an identity, and you're not being issued with a token. And how I like to explain this is to point the audience to something like Facebook, Google account, that's your Gmail account. You realize it's one ID. Let's look at Google. One ID for your Gmail account. But whenever you visit YouTube or Google Docs, it doesn't. That service on the other side doesn't ask you to authenticate again, isn't it? Yeah? But you can see your name up there. You edit your documents, they remain under your account, but you didn't authenticate. Maybe you only authenticated once when accessing email. But the Google Docs service, YouTube, these are totally different services, but you're able to access them using one identity. So that's the same idea when it comes to the most mentioned word today, gateway. We have this science gateway sitting out there, and with one ID, which you have been issued by an identity provider, which, like KENET in this case, we are the IDP provider for the KENET network, or maybe even the country, you are able to access the various science gateways. So it's also good to mention that this is different from OSID, which I saw in one of the presentations earlier, or Research ID, which is basically for keeping track of research output online. Science gateways, these have been mentioned throughout the day, so maybe no one need to repeat this. Again, a slide which has been used by most presenters today. So away from that, what else do we have at KENET? We provide what we refer to as research collaboration tools. And this is basically video conferencing services. We have web conferencing, or even if you can think of it as doing web video conferencing on your browser, or even desktop-based conferencing just like Skype. But these ones have been developed for the research community, and these services are available for you to start to use, collaborating with your colleagues. And then aside from this, let's say you're a researcher and you wish to test an application, or you want to host some data somewhere. KENET already has got two tier 3 data centers, which you can request for services. And we have virtualization services. This is where you access virtual computers and colocation services. Let's say you have some servers and you wish to host them somewhere, you can bring them to KENET. And then also disaster recovery site hosting, which you're already doing for a number of universities and some of our members. So a very important slide here. How do you get started using these services? Just takes one email and we'll kickstart the conversation. Just tell us what you want. Just drop us an email at support@kenet.org.ke and we'll get talking. So I would like to stop there and looking forward to your questions later on in the session. Thank you.